Now, the second topic of the atmospheric boundary layer topic. There's three topics, remember? First is the characteristics of the boundary layer. He's talking about the depth, and then the temperature profile, the relative humidity profile, and so on, the different layers, and so on. So those are the descriptive properties of the boundary layer. Now we talk about the statistical description of turbulence which occurs in the atmospheric boundary layer. Now, this particular field in atmospheric boundary layer and also this statistical description of turbulence is my research field. But this is going to be more mathematical. Now, we are introduced to turbulence by the mention of eddies. Remember, there are many different sizes of eddies in the atmosphere, and then these eddies are very important because it carries moisture, it carries pollution, it carries heat, and so on. It carries, when I say it carries, it is able to communicate or transport these things between different layers. You can think of it like, how is drag communicated to the upper layer? It's through turbulence. How does energy gets communicated from the upper layer to the bottom? It's through turbulence as well. So turbulence carries all of these things. And when it carries, that means it controls, it affects the state of the atmosphere. So that's why we need to study turbulence, because of this, it's a vehicle to carry all these factors. But turbulence is difficult to study because it's very, I think you know, turbulence is very chaotic, very random. Difficult for you to quantify it, right? Not like, let's say, an analytical equation where you just plug in the values and you get an exact value of the exact answer. And that's why we resort to statistics to do it, because of these many variations, we cannot pinpoint on one particular value, so we have to use statistics to quantify this instead of just having a single value like this sort of equation. So that's what it means by this Taylor's hypothesis statement. We use Taylor's hypothesis to quantify or to describe turbulence, and we use statistics to do it. So to simplify turbulence measurements and study, G.I. Taylor, the name, a person, suggested that, I think in the 1920s or 1910s, suggested that for some special cases, turbulence or eddies might be considered to be frozen as it advects past the sensor. So that is Taylor's hypothesis. So we assume certain things about turbulence so that we can describe it statistically. Right? Or else it's too random for us to study it. Which means that the turbulence is frozen as it advects past the sensor. So here's a diagram after this, but let me just give you a preview of this. Okay, this is the sensor, and we know turbulence is like that. Okay. So according to this Taylor hypothesis, an assumption, this turbulence is frozen. That means it does not change its characteristic as it goes past this sensor. Like say at time 1, it's this value. At time 2, it's this value, and so on. Time 3, at this value. And this variation, as it passes through this, is going to be the same. So maybe at this point, okay, maybe time 2 is 30 seconds from here, and this is at 0 seconds. So after 30 seconds, this sensor would experience the value at this time. And this is going to be maintained as it goes through the sensor. So that is Taylor's hypothesis. So basically, if you just put a sensor in the middle of a field and there's wind coming through the sensor, we say that 30 seconds in the future, we will face the same temperature as position of that wind somewhere 30 seconds downwind. So what it means by frozen. But of course, it's not exactly that way, right? It will change based on maybe some obstructions and so on. But by using this hypothesis, we assume that it is the same. And if we just place a sensor in the middle, the sensor is going to experience the scale of turbulence that is coming to it. Okay, this is in opposed to having a sensor. If you really want to measure turbulence, right, correctly without following this assumption, what you need to do is you have to have a sensor for each position. Sensor each position. A sensor here, sensor here, sensor here. Each position have a sensor. And then this all measures at the same time. Then that can be considered as real turbulence measurements because that's frozen. But here, if you don't have all these sensors, you only have one sensor, we assume that this sensor is able to capture the variation for all the sensors. So that's just a limitation of the limitation of how we can measure something, because to have all this is, of course, going to be quite expensive, quite difficult to do. And furthermore, how do you know that the wind is coming from this direction, right? So if you want to measure turbulence, like I mentioned in eddy covariance study, the Stern paper, then you have to have a grid of sensors that measures all the parameters at the same time. Then it's able to capture the turbulence, the changes here, actually captured. But then if you don't have it, if you only have one sensor, you assume that this statistics of this coming here is going to be the same as if you measure it every point. So Taylor hypothesis is that if you have one sensor here, you're able to capture the statistics of this by having just one sensor. And I hope you understand this now when I say turbulence might be considered as to be frozen as it advects past the sensor. So something like that. Same thing as what I described here. So this is an eddy. This is the sensor, and this is the wind carrying the eddy. This end of the eddy is 5 degrees Celsius. This end of the eddy is 10 degrees Celsius, 100 meters. So after a certain time, this eddy would be here, carries by the wind, and then this thing will be pick up 5 degrees Celsius, the one that no one's before, something like this. So assuming the mean air temperature is 7 degrees Celsius, plot the air temperature measured by the tower thermometer. So let's say the average is 7 degrees Celsius. At zero second, now, 10 degrees Celsius. So it's 10 degrees Celsius. After 10 seconds, then this eddy, this part of the eddy would move here. So it becomes 5 degrees Celsius. And then as it goes away, then it's 7 degrees Celsius again. But the assumption is that the eddies are made up of many temperatures, and as they pass through with time, you capture those variations. That is for temperature, but it also can be applied for moisture. It can also be applied for wind and all the other meteorological parameters. So assuming there are a large number of eddies with different temperature features and different scales at back past the sensor, can you imagine how the temperature record looks like? Something like that. Something that you see, right? When you measure temperature in the air. It's made of many types of eddies. Just now, the previous slide is just one eddy. So it's just one increase and decrease and so on. This is the actual temperature reading. Have you seen this also in Weather Underground? Those variations. So these variations caused by the different types of eddies.